Okay, so good morning. So in today's class we'll be discussing about the benefits of group technology, and we'll be discussing about how cellular manufacturing is working and what are the how cellular manufacturing can be implemented or used in a organization. So those things we'll be discussing in today's class. So as we discussed in the last class about part families, by now you will be able to understand why we need to segregate the parts into part family as per the GT codes, or what we call as group technology codes. Okay, so we are having different benefits of wide spectrum of benefits when you say about group technology. So as I told you in the last class, when we have engineering design, with respect to engineering design, what is the advantage? Like, we can reduce the number of new parts we are designing. I hope you remember the last class discussion where only the flank diameter, the length has to be increased for one component or another component. So in that case, you told me that, sir, we no need to rewrite the program. We have to just change the, make a small change in the CNC coding to have the part B. Okay, so you know how it works, right? So when you have the segregation or clustering based upon the group technology code, we know that the time what is consumed or the activity what is reduced to design a new part can be avoided if they have some similarity with the existing design which the company is already having in its database. Okay, so and also we will have a standardization, because when we are going to say that design can be used or copied from the existing design, that means the existing design should be of some standard. So the uniformity or the uniform standard will be followed in that particular company. Okay, so that is one advantage. That is, see, all drawings will be having some similar ethical standardizations. So that is there. Then, so easy retrieval is possible. What is easy retrieval? Okay, as I told you, you have the design A and design B, and as per the last class discussion, if design B has just the change in length of the product, just by taking the you can easily retrieve the similar components, and you can check whether the design is going to match or not. If the designs are matching, what you can do, you can make some adjustment, and you can identify the similar functional parts. So that is possible. Okay, so that is one way how in engineering design the group technology is going to help. Okay, now let's come to layout planning. When you are designing the layout, how this is going to helpful, right? So when you follow layout planning, what happens, the shop floor space can be reduced. How? Because when you are designing the product, you are going as per the group technology layout, the space which is required previously, like you thought, because since you are grouping the products based upon the some similarities, the design attributes or the production attributes of production features, what happens is that product, you no need to repeat the layouts. You no need to repeat the layouts, because in the existing layout itself, you can do some adjustments and you can plan to manufacture the particular product. So this floor space is going to be reduced. Also, the material handling effort, because since you're going to arrange the machines as per the group GT, group technology coding system, the machines are going to be placed in as per the flow of the product or as per the routing of the product. That's why the material handling, because the effort taken from moving from one goods to one place to another place can be reduced drastically. So that is one advantages of group technology when it comes to plant layouting or layout planning. Okay, then specifications of equipment, tools, jigs and fixtures. So if you are having manufacturing products which are similar in nature, what happens? The machines what they are going to be using, or the equipments which are used in that particular process, can be will be similar, and also there can you can have a very standardized tools. Say for example, you go to a small automobile repair shop, a bike repair shop. They will arrange all their equipments, the spanners or all the equipments whatever they require to repair in certain order. And only, and there will be a standardized order, like all this spanners will be kept in one sequence of arrangement from small to big or big to small, the numbers, right? And same way, all their screwdrivers, so whatever they require will be kept in some order of requirement. So that's how, because and that will become a standardized way of doing things. Okay, so when you know what you are going to do or how you are going to cluster it, the standardization will be made possible in an easy manner. Then implementation of cellular manufacturing system will, okay, group technology is the foundation for cellular manufacturing. So group technology, when you know have group technology, you will know how to do the cellular manufacturing systems. Then so what the cost involved in releasing the new product can be brought down, because the tools, jigs, fixture, whatever you are using for the earlier design of similar component can be used for the new design with some little bit of modification. So that is possible. So the cost spent on tools, jigs, and fixtures can also be reduced to a certain extent. Then when you're going for manufacturing process planning, since you organize the parts in some clusters, what happens is that you can reduce the setup time and you can reduce the production time also. So when you're able to reduce the setup time and production time, the total time taken to manufacture the product will also be less. So when the total time taken by the product to get manufactured, if it's less, automatically there's going to be a big cost saving for the company. So grouping of similar parts is going to help us in reducing the setup time as well as the production time, and at the end the overall time. So the lead time market comes to becomes less. That is, you can manufacture the product very quickly and deliver it to the customers very fast. So the lead time gets reduced here, and when the lead time is reduced, the customer will be happy and you are going to earn more number of customers and more number of profit indirectly. Okay, then with the help of this group technology, what happens is that in planning your process, you will have a routing plan. That is, if the plan A is not there, you can go for the plan B. That is, if you want to use this machine A and go to B and C and D, and there will be also a substitute machine for A, like A1 or A2, by which you can form the, you can suddenly change, if there's a bottleneck, you will be able to shift your production to the another lane, because you may also have a similar kind of production activity of the, or the similar kind of product going in the another line, another assembly line or another production line. So you can plan for alternate processes if you follow group technology. Then, as I told you, you can reduce the number of machining operations in certain case, and you can also save the time it spent on coding your new CNC programming and all these things. So those things are possible when it comes to manufacturing process plan. Okay, so the next what we have is called as manufacturing production control. When you have a control over the production activity, you can reduce your work in process inventory. That means you know this product will take this much time and the product B will take this much time, and at the end of the day, totally you will be able to reduce the production, the work in progress, that is the number of items under progress, that is the waiting time can be reduced drastically. So this, when you do this, you will be able to reduce your bottlenecks. And you can create a improved material flow from material flow. So if you have improved material flow, automatically your money spent on the warehouse will be coming down, because if you know how your material is going to flow correctly, you can plan for just-in-time approach. That is, you can get the raw materials or the semi-finished products from your suppliers at the right time, at the right place, only when you require. So that is called as just-in-time approach. That is, you need some items in the morning for today's production, your activity, your supplier can give all the raw materials what is required, delivered, say for example, you're starting the production at 10 o'clock, your supplier can give it to you at 9 o'clock. So that is called as just-in-time approach. So whenever you require something, you are getting delivered. So that is just-in-time approach. So, and this also lead to faster response to schedule changes. So if there is any change in the production activity or the production change, if there is some nervousness in the MRP or there's a change in the MPS, your system will work out, because if they have some similar components, they can be utilized here also. So MRP and MPS, if there is any changes, even then the system can cope up if you follow group technology. Then as I told you again, if the fixtures, jigs, pallets, tools can be reused for multiple products depending upon their classification. So that is one advantage. So again, when it comes to quality, so the number of defects can be reduced. You can reduce the scrap quantity generated, and you can have a better quality in the product, in the market. And the role of supervisors or the accountability of the quality engineers in the company will come down, because when you follow some similar, if the parts are made up of similar nature, the quality engineer or the quality supervisor or the one who is checking the quality of the product will have a, because the patterns are going to be repeated, he will know what will be exactly the problem in the particular variant, and he can be able to check it very quickly. Okay, so say for example, if you are going to drill a hole, okay, and what happens when you drill a hole? The hole should not be inclined, or the hole should be straight, or something like that. So all problems related to hole can be addressed by the quality engineer depending upon the process, because if the company is going to manufacture all products with holes with the drilling operation involved, automatically the quality engineer will get trained more in checking the quality of hole drilled. So that is one way by which group technology is going to help the quality people. Then when it comes to coding, what happens? When it comes to purchasing, what happens because of the coding? Now they will know, okay, for this kind of product, this, he is the best supplier. Okay, say for example, if a company is buying more number of steel, and they know when they keep on buying steel from for the particular product or the particular products grouped together, the part family, they'll understand, okay, this kind of product will require this grade of steel, and this grade of steel will be supplied by my supplier in this quality. So for this kind of steel, I should approach this supplier because he will be giving me in this quality. So they will be able, the clarity of information on purchasing raw material will be very, very easy for the purchasing department. And since you know where the raw material will be available, the process of purchasing will be simple, and there can be small cost cutting which can happen in the purchasing activity also. Right, because instead of searching for more number of suppliers, they can go, okay, for this product is the best supplier, will go and buy, right? So that's why in purchasing, some kind of cost cutting can be used. And also multiple buying will not be there. That is, for product A you buy some steel EN38, and product B you buy EN32 or something like that. But there may be a product C which will also require EN38. So two products needing EN38 grade steel, so that they can buy the steel from, if they're buying planning for product A, they can also plan the purchase activity for product number C, because both are going to use the same material. If that is not the case, the company will place the order for A separately and for C separately, even though they require the EN38 steel, the steel grade is similar for both the parts. They may end up in buying it separately one time from one customer, from one supplier, and for part C from another supplier. So this can happen. So multiple purchasing activity can be avoided if you know that if two products are in need of the same raw material. Then when you buy similar buying options, what happens? The number of vendors what you are going to handle will also get down. So if you are not going to handle with multiple suppliers or the multiple vendors, what happens? Your accounting activity or costing activity will come less. Also, when you have less number of vendors or suppliers, automatically you can plan for just-in-time purchase. So when you adopt just-in-time approach, what happens? Automatically, the cost of the product is the cost of warehouse or the cost of inventory is going to come down. So more number of suppliers, more complex is the supply chain, and more complex is the supply chain, more complex is the product, the arrival of raw materials in your workplace. So to avoid that confusion, if you have less number of for vendors or suppliers, you will have less number of complexity in, you have low complexity in your supply chain, and that will lead to less inventory in the warehouse. When you have less inventory in the warehouse, automatically over a period of time, you can plan for just-in-time approach. Okay, so that is one possibility of having clustering the products by group technology. So at the end, when it comes to the customer, what happens? The customer can get fast product okay, the product can be delivered, because the lead time can be reduced. If you follow group technology, the product will reach the customer quick, and also it will be easy for them to plan for the spare parts or spare parts. So there are some vehicles, or say for example, some, most of the times the mobile phones are released in the market very quickly, but this mobile phones will find the suppliers will find the spare parts for this mobile phone to get because you know that mobile phone companies almost every week they are launching a new mobile phone before this COVID. So what happens when they launch so many number of mobile phones, the spare parts for this mobile phone will not be available at the same time when the mobile is being released in the market. You're buying a phone on Monday and you're dropping it somewhere you're dropping it on the floor and the glass breaks. You take it to the customer on Friday, they will tell us, sorry sir, the product is new in the market and we don't have the spare parts, or we don't have the screen to get replaced. You need to wait for some certain period of time because we need to place the order and we need to get the spare parts. So this may be the situation. So when you follow group technology, you can also plan for spare parts management in a quicker manner. So ultimately, the entire process will reduce the lead time to the market. So thereby, group technology is going to play a major role in improving the process from raw material stage to the customer stage. So from raw material stage to the finished product stage until it gets delivered to the customer, and even after post delivery to the customer, this group technology is going to play a vital role in reducing the lead time, reducing the cost, reducing the inventory and everything. The overall cost spent, so that will be that can be reduced. Okay, so now let's get back to get to cellular manufacturing. What is cellular manufacturing? Okay, as I told you, as we were discussing, the cellular manufacturing is the process by which you are going to produce the part families. Okay, now we have identified the part families and we are going to produce the part families using a single line or what you call or by using a certain number of machines put in a cell with certain number of workers who are working in the line or the cell. Okay, what is a cell? Imagine a big a small factory is there. If you are putting a small factory, there's a big factory and there are small factories, right? For to make it simple, I will give you the example. Inside VIT University, mechanical engineering department is one cell, computer science engineering is one cell, biotechnology is one cell, civil engineering is one cell. So imagine these are the production units in small size put in a big campus or big in a larger factory. So each and every cell is now going to do the some activity. For example, mechanical cell is going to produce mechanical engineering, biotechnology department is going to produce biotechnologist, and computer science engineering will be produced by the computer science department. So these departments are now called as cell. Okay, small cells which produce different products. And to produce these different products, there will be different machines put in the cell to do the production activity. Okay, so this unit has that means the mechanical engines will be produced by the mechanical engineering department alone. So that is called as the cell. So here, if you just give the raw material into the cell, ultimately the products will come out from the cell, like product or the parts can be manufactured from the particular cell. So all necessary machines and manpower will be available in the cell. Say for example, again getting back, in a mechanical engineering department, all faculties with mechanical engineering subject knowledge will be available, all laboratories all laboratories or all machines related to mechanical engineering will be available in mechanical engineering department to produce mechanical engineers. Okay, same way in a company, if they want to produce some kind of product, say for example, a company is going to manufacture tires, all necessary components, the wires, the rubber, the molding units, the compression units, the quality check, everything will be available inside one small factory, and that is called as a cell. Okay, that means that to manufacture something, everything will be made available in a particular place. So that is called as manufacturing cell. Okay, so and here what happens, if you are going for a cellular manufacturing, your labor should be highly trained. That means they should be able to handle all equipments or all machines in the particular cell, so that it becomes easy for them to operate many machines by a single labor will be able to manage more than one number of machine. So it will be easy for them to have less number of employees or less number of labors in the to handle the machines or the equipments. So that is possible. And also job rotation is possible. What is job rotation? Say for example, there is one worker who knows how to manufacture a shaft, and there is one worker who is very good at milling machine. So if you hire, then you need to hire two people to handle the lathe separately and the milling machine separately. But rather, if you could have an operator who is highly skilled in lathe operation and handling the milling operation, then it's easy to handle both the machines by the single operator. So that is one advantages of having laborers with high technical knowledge. So what happens now? So a single labor can be used to handle both milling machine and the lathe machine. And imagine if there are two workers, if the second worker is not available on the particular day to do the job, all the activities will be bottlenecked, or there will be a disturbance in the flow of the product, or the production activity can be even halted. So to avoid that, there should be laborers who can handle multiple jobs, or they should be basically highly skilled or trained to handle multiple jobs. So also in some cases, if one worker is not available, the other worker can take his responsibility. That is, anyone in the company can handle any machine or work with any kind of equipment that is available in the company. So in case of cellular manufacturing, the worker should be highly trained. Okay, so when you say this, then when you are going for the cellular manufacturing, automatically your performance is going to be high. What kind of performance? Your productivity is going to increase, your cycle time is going to increase, and also the logistics, like otherwise the movement of materials from one place to another place in the company, is going to get reduced. So automatically what happens? The prices, the number of pieces, the number of workpiece produced by manufactured by a labor in a particular hour is going to increase. That is, the number of pieces per man hour is going to increase, the unit cost is going to come down, on-time delivery will be possible, lead time can be reduced, defect rates can be reduced, and overall the percentage of parts made in a cell will be high. Okay, there is more productivity will be there if you're going for cellular manufacturing. And again, this is like arranging different machines with different functionalities in close to each other, and the result will be a standalone manufacturing unit. That is, you're going to put say for example, to make it simple, imagine all faculties in mechanical engineering department as machines. One professor will be a specialist in industrial engineering, another professor will be good at thermodynamics, another professor in fluid mechanics, another professor in composites, another professor in thermal engineering. So if, say for example, if you are going to put all these faculties, that is, these are different faculties with different capabilities or functionalities or features, they are going to be put in one particular cell, that is mechanical engineering department, to produce mechanical engineers of all, having all knowledges of all, combined knowledge of all these professors. So that's how this is cellular manufacturing. So it's going to be different machines, a lathe, a drilling, a plate, electroplating machine, everything is going to be put into one cell for manufacturing the product. So here what happens? It's going to be different combination of different machines, but they're going to produce similar components. Different machines, but similar components, because they're going to be based upon some part families. So it's in general we call cellular manufacturing as a miniature plant inside a larger factory. Okay, a small factory is inside the big factories. Okay, that's all. So now this arrangement of machines will be, even though the machines are going to be functionally different, they can be grouped together based upon some geometrical similarities. Okay, they are going to be grouped based upon some geometrical similarities. So that is possible. Again, so they will be adopting a certain kind of routing process, or they'll be having some process by which they are going to be manufactured. So the cells can be with the normally the machines in the cells are going to be arranged one after the another. So thereby the movement of material from one machine to another machine can be reduced, or they can be handled manually. But there are some cases where it's going to be fully automated. So conveyor deployment of a conveyor system is also a good idea in a cellular manufacturing system. So if you observe the cellular manufacturing system, it is going to be a combination of a product layout and the job shop. In a job shop, there are small machines available to complete one manufacturing, one product at a time. Okay, so same way, it is like small job shop, but with the production layout. With the idea of product layout. Small job shop arranged in sequence of a product layout will be looking like a cellular manufacturing layout. Okay, so when you have a cellular design, what happens? There will be a quick and efficient flow of materials happening. High productivity is going to happen, and there will be a flexibility in the job shop. So this cellular manufacturing is. Later, after the evolution of the cellular manufacturing, later it gave a pathway to a path-breaking idea of something called as flexible manufacturing system. What is this flexible manufacturing system? Okay, so to make it simple, let's take the example of VAT again. Say for example, the regular process is how there will be a classroom, there will be a subject where the faculty will come to the classroom, and you are going to enroll in the first year or second year or the third year. You study the courses with the same faculty for the full semester, and you are not going to move from one department to another department. But when you have a flexible credit system, what happens? You move from one department to another department, and you select the faculties, and you select the course, you select the time. So some flexibility is there. So this is just to give an idea of flexibility. Same way in a company, depending upon the product, the machines can be quickly arranged in certain pattern, which is based upon the routing or the process flowchart of the product. The machines can be quickly arranged, and it can be used for production of the component. So that is also possible. So when you have cellular manufacturing, automatically the flexibility will be more, and this flexibility later gave birth to the technology called as flexible manufacturing system. In short, we called as FMS. FMS means in industrial engineering, FMS means flexible manufacturing system. So that is one advantages of this cellular manufacturing. So when I say issues, when we are going to adopt cellular manufacturing, and there are going to be some complex or broad implications of this. The organization has to undergo certain issues will be there. That is, one is going to be on system structure, the other one is going to be on operation structure or operational issues. Okay, we call it structural issues and procedural issues. In structure issues, it is going to be how to group the products into the part families, or how we are going to select the machines based upon the process, based upon the number of quantities to be produced, what tool you are going to search. What fixtures you'll be using, what kind of pallets you're going to use, what kind of material equipment you're going to use, what kind of layout you're going to plan. So all this comes under structural issues. When it's going to be the procedure issues, it's going to be how detailing is the design available. Okay, how my supervisor or the support persons are available at the cells. What kind of maintenance or the inspection policy I'm going to adopt. What kind of production planning, scheduling activity, controlling activity, or usage of any software or hardware is going to be planned. How I'm going to modify the cost, or how I'm going to give the reward systems are going to be planned. So all these things are going to, the flow of information or flow of job or the planning of materials. So everything comes into which will arise as a major issue when it comes to cellular manufacturing. But it can be avoided, right? So to do that, we are going to how this is going to be evaluated, right? Say for example, how this evaluations are going to happen for the cell designs, right? So that can be again classified as system structure. In system structure, by cellular manufacturing, we are going to ensure low equipment and tooling investment. Okay, the cost spent on tooling is going to be less. Then if you're going to relocate any equipment, the cost should be less. the material handling cost should be less, the floor space requirement should be less. But at the same time, what happens? The parts are going to be more number of. We should try to manufacture more number of parts in the in a cell, and that should be high flexibility should be available. So if you are planning a cell, it should have all these characteristics. And when it comes to the system operation, what are your cell should be evaluated. You should ensure that your cell is going to have high equipment utilization. There should not be any work in process. That means as soon as the raw material enters, it should get finished and you should go out, right? Or the machine should not be waiting for a long time in a queue. So the queue length or the queue time should be less. Then in a given less time, amount of time, the number of jobs should be produced should be high. Okay, and there should not be any job lateness. That is, the product should not get delayed for any reason in any stage of this manufacturing activity. So throughout the manufacturing process, it should sail smoothly. Okay, so to do this for machines, what are the approaches available? So the first approach, what we saw, is called as rank order clustering algorithm. There is one more thing called as machine component group analysis. Okay, the process is called as machine component group analysis. This is very, very simple process. Just in next 5 minutes, we'll be able to understand what is this machine component group analysis. This machine component group analysis is based upon production flow analysis. Okay, production flow analysis. This production flow analysis is made up of 4 simple stages. The first stage is machine classification. First, what we are going to do, the machines which can perform similar operations are going to be grouped together. So instead of first, what we are doing, we are grouping the machines based upon their similarities of manufacturing process. Okay, or they can be even arranged based upon the number of components they can manufacture in a particular time. So the high productive machines and machines with high similarities are grouped together. Next, checking part list and production route information. That is, we are going to see, okay, this part, we are going to list down all the parts and we are going to draw the process chart, a process chart for all this part. That is, part A will require a milling machine, a drilling machine, and a electroplating. The second component may need machine number 2, that is drilling and electroplating alone. The third component may require only the milling machine alone. So what happens now? So now this, based upon this similarities, the parts can be the machines can be arranged in certain idea on how this is going to be done. Okay, next, the factory flow analysis. Then now it is micro level. Okay, so far we did macro level, now it is going to go micro level. What happens now? For the entire factory, we can flat. Okay, it knows micro level examination of flow of components through machines. Okay, so what happens now? Now we arrange the machines based upon the process, now based upon the product. Okay, process based layout, product based layout. So both the things we are going to follow. Then after doing this, what we are going to do, we are going to prepare a matrix. In this machine component group analysis, we are going to prepare a matrix like machines are the products, the parts which are going to use similar machines will be marked and they are going to be grouped accordingly. Say for example, I give you this example. So this is a matrix. Say for example, in this example, all of you please note down this problem. Okay, so in this problem, you see there are 6 parts, part number 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, and there are 4 machines, machine 1, machine 2, machine 3, and machine 4. Okay, now will we be able to cluster these machines or group these machines based upon the machine component group analysis? How you can arrange these machines? What kind of arrangement you should make to make it as a machine cell? Which parts and which machines should be put in one cell, and what are the machines which should be placed in cell number 2? Can anyone answer this? Which machines need to be placed together, or which parts should be placed together in one cell? And there are 2 cells, you can form 2 cells out of this matrix. What are they?
Sir, machine 1, 3 and 5 in one cell and 2, 4 and 6 in another cell.
Come again. There are parts 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Machines, there are only 4.
Yes, sir. Like parts 1, 3 and 5 in one cell and 2, 4 and 6 in another cell.
Very good. So that's done. So that's how you have done your machine component group analysis. Machine component group analysis is done. Simple. So this is possible when you are doing with a less number of components and less number of machines. This was very easy. Okay, this is something like that is called as machine component group analysis. Now understand, to make you to understand very simple about the cellular manufacturing, let me give you one small example or how to plan this machines, right? There's a buffet, right? In a buffet, what happens, all starters are kept in one place, all other items, the main items in one place, the veg in one place, the non-veg in one place, or sometimes the fruits or the ice creams in one place. So all these things are kept, the salads are in one place, right? So they're grouped upon some similarities, that is group technology, and they're kept in some order, that is called as cellular manufacturing. That is, all ice creams are kept in one place, all starters in one place. So that is grouping into cell. Already they are classified based upon the product nature, and they are grouped in one particular cell. So that is called cellular manufacturing. That is one simple example by which you can understand cellular manufacturing and group technology. So since if the number of components are less or the machine is less, you can easily go with this machine component group analysis. If not, you will be going into this rank order clustering algorithm or binary order algorithm or Fink's algorithm. That is nothing but your rank order clustering algorithm, which is solved in the last previous class. Okay, and I think in your digital assignment also, you should have solved your problem based upon rank order clustering algorithm. I think you you will be knowing how to solve a rank order clustering algorithm also. Okay, first by rows, then rearranging, then as per column, then rearranging. Okay, and this was the problem I think which was given to you as a digital assignment. This is the final solution which you would have obtained by solving this rank order cluster algorithm, your digital assignment solution. Okay, so in the next class, what we will do is we will learn about this cluster identification algorithm, or what we call as CIA. Okay, next class we'll see about this cluster identification algorithm. So that is very simple algorithm. Just you have to strike out some columns and rows, then you'll be getting the solution. So let's wind up the class for today. What I'll do is I'll post a quiz in the forum. Just try to answer that.